There's a great clip actually from Bill Belichick, the head coach from the Patriots, in their film room, and he's actually showing a clip where they're in a game and someone had a sack and nobody once gave a high five, right? And everybody just kind of walked back to the huddle. They ended up losing that game. And then he showed another clip where somebody scored a touchdown and an offensive lineman were swarming the running back and how well they played and how Mudita can actually help you get the O, the outcome that you want.
Put that coffee down.
Creators are leaders. Be careful what kind of leaders you're producing here.
Helen, we're both in sales.
Let me tell you why I suck as a salesman.
They realized that to be in power, you didn't need guns or money or even numbers. You just needed the will to do what the other guy wouldn't.
I'm not leaving. The show goes on.
Hey there, friends. Welcome back to the Construction Leadership Podcast. I am your host, Bradley Hartman. On this show, we bring you ideas and insights from leaders across the country every single week to help you lead more effectively. This episode is brought to you by the Simple Sales Pipeline. If you're in construction and you have sales professionals who are not, with consistency and discipline, forecasting future revenue, we're flying blind into an uncertain future. What do? Should we buy a huge CRM and invest six figures and take 3 years to implement it? No, don't do that. You can solve it in 30 minutes or less once a month for less than $30. Learn more by visiting thesimplesalespipeline.com. Now, one of the ways that we get wonderful guests on our show is when we have friends or clients of ours who are working with other people in the industry, and they say things like, this guy, Steve Jones, you have to know, and you got to have him on your podcast because he has fantastic frameworks and mental models when it comes to leadership and building strong teams, and we've experienced that, and he's a sports guy, so you're going to fall in love with him. So this feedback came from two individuals that I really, really enjoy. I was going to say adore. I'm not sure if I adore them. I'm not sure how they would feel about that, but I respect them a lot. Jen Zern and Doug Carlson, who were both together on episode 224 of the Construction Leadership Podcast. If you have not listened to that, you should go back and listen to it. Both of them are very smart and insightful, and they're fun to talk to. They're easy to talk to, so you'll enjoy that. So episode 224. They shared that information with me about Steve Jones. And when I get feedback like that, I act upon it quickly. Steve was really easy to get a hold of. And as you will hear in this conversation, he has a lot to offer any team who wants to improve their overall performance. And for any individuals like you, like me, who want to become better leaders. So what do we know about Steve Jones? Steve Jones attended the University of Wisconsin, Stevens Point. Mascot? The Pointers. That's right. Not the Pointer Sisters. Totally different. Like the Pointers, like a dog, like a hunting dog, the Pointers. Anyway, he then got into teaching and coaching at the high school level. And to say that he was successful really puts shame to people who are actually just kind of normally successful. He was a coach for 11 years. He went 129-9. 129 wins and 9 losses over 11 years. 5 state championships and won 70 consecutive games in a row. Now, I can share confidently with you as someone who played high school and college football and struggled to put together teams that won 1 or 2 or 3 or 5 or 6 games in a row. 70-0 when every year you're turning over like 35% of your team due to graduation. Like that is absolutely fantastic and crazy. And you can see why he's in demand now with professional teams and professional athletes, obviously, companies that are in the construction space, like Myron Construction, obviously Zern Building Products. So he was a lot of fun to talk to. And we start diving into this book called The Twin Thieves, How Great Leaders Build Great Teams, which I would strongly recommend to a friend. I really enjoyed this. And this book came at a really good time for me and our team personally. So we talk a lot about different things related to individual leadership, but also building strong teams that stick together and continue winning. And I know for many of you, you've had really successful years over the past 2, 3, 5, maybe 10 years coming out of the Great Recession. And part of this is, how do you continue to evolve your teams to continue the success and not falling into some of these somewhat predictable traps that happen on teams, whether it's in high school or college or professional teams, and certainly us in the construction industry. So you, my friends, you're in for a treat. Without further ado, please enjoy my conversation with Mr. Steve Jones, author of The Twin Thieves. Mr. Steve Jones, welcome to the show.
Oh, thanks for having me. I'm excited about this conversation.
Yeah, likewise. Well, if only we were able to block out 7 hours on the podcast, we'd be able to get through this because I don't have notes on every page, but there's notes on a lot of pages. So I'm excited to kind of dive in here. And I think for me and my team, this was extremely apt. The concepts and the timing as we're growing our business. And we will mention this a little bit later, but Zurn, lumber building material dealer in Wisconsin, is how we got connected. And I'm always on the lookout for clients that we're working with and when they are absolutely raving about their work with other consultants. And I want to know, like, what are they doing? And they absolutely raved about you. And that was the connection here. So whatever you're doing, and we're going to talk about those things, congratulations on your success.
I appreciate it. Yeah, they're a great partner, amazing people there, amazing company, and thankful for the connection here. So thank you.
Absolutely. So let's dive in here. Name of the title, The Twin Thieves, How Great Leaders Build Great Teams. What are the Twin Thieves?
Yeah, so we labeled the Twin Thieves the fear of failure and the fear of judgment. And the idea of it is the fear of failure, fear of judgment, sometimes they get mixed up. So sometimes twins get mixed up. There's a lot of people out there that will say, you know, I'm scared of failure. But the more questions you ask and you get deeper to the root, you realize that it's not even the failure itself they're worried about. They're really worried about the judgment that comes after the failure. So the fear of failure, fear of judgment sometimes get mixed up like twins. And then we call them thieves because we believe that they can rob people. They can rob teams and organizations of a lot of things. Taking positive risks, success, joy in the process. I mean, I could go on and on. We believe that they're the biggest thieves in America right now for a lot of different reasons. But the reason why we call them that and label it is I think there's power in labeling some of these things that are holding us back. It's impossible to beat an invisible opponent. So when we place a name to them, it's a little bit easier to rise above them. But yeah, we've gotten thousands and thousands of data points from kids, from young leaders to adults, CEOs, people that are crushing it across industry. And really, when you kind of get down to the root of what's holding them back and maybe holding their team back, it's usually one of those two thieves or both of them.
I love the fact that you introduce those in the book and then you say something really interesting. You say, now here's the deal. Once we identify fear of failure, fear of judgment, we don't try to eliminate them. And I read that and I stopped. Obviously, I was going to continue reading, but I wanted to take a step back and say, all right, why would I not want to eliminate them? And I thought you do a wonderful job of carrying that story through, but maybe go into a little more detail there. Why do we not want to eliminate them if they're thieves?
Yeah, because, you know, to a certain extent, I think they can drive you. Fear can be a good thing in some ways, right? You know, it helps keep us alive. Sometimes it provides us with a little bit of motivation, some extra kick. But when it becomes a hindrance, when it's really holding us back, when the fear of failure, fear of judgment really holding us back, that's when we need to continue to rise above them. And we believe that they're just impossible to eliminate. You know, so we oftentimes look at it as if your journey is on a car, right? You have choices. You cannot throw them out of the car, but you can take the Twin Thieves. Some people allow them to drive the car. So they got control of the wheel and every decision they make in their life is based on the fear of failure and the fear of judgment. You know, what happens if I mess up? What are people going to think? Some people put them in the passenger seat. So they get a little bit of control. They have control over the radio or the aux cord. And then some people, and we feel like the highest performers have the courage to throw them in the trunk and saying, yeah, you're going to be with us, but you don't have control. And we also feel like what you resist persists. So we got to learn how to dance with the fear of failure and not try to just simply eliminate it. And it's kind of like taking a big beach ball and putting it under the water in the ocean. If you constantly just try to push it away and make it go away, eventually you're going to get worn out and that beach ball is going to explode through the water, usually at the worst time, right? And so if we're constantly resisting it and trying to push it out totally, it's never going away. So we just got to learn how to dance with it.
So I'll throw this at you. A little history. I know basketball isn't your primary sport, but I know you're a sports guy. So there's a couple of legendary stories. Essentially, the identical scenario happened with Wilt Chamberlain, one of the greatest of all times, and Shaquille O'Neal. They had different coaches, but the rub of the story was when their mechanics, and being, I think, so big and having such large hands, terrible free throw shooters. And Shaq was with Rick Barry, and I forget who Wilt Chamberlain's coach was. But anyway, they got with coaches separated by decades that taught them how to shoot the ball underhand. And both of them saw miraculous improvement in what was terrible free throw shooting that was limiting their ability to play in the fourth quarter and help their team wins. Both of them tried it. Shaq was only in a practice, but Wilt did it for like a season, shot underhand, and went from like making 45% to like 50% of his free throws up to like the high 70s or low 80s. Both of them concluded though, and kind of your like fear of judgment, both of them said, you know what? I feel like I'm being a sissy shooting grandma style, granny style. And both of them stopped. So when I read that about just the fear of judgment, that's it. I mean, that's the fear of looking dumb. If you had these professional athletes, especially some of the best of all time, how might you get them to think a little bit about changing their behavior?
That's a great story. And just imagine if Wilt was around now with TikTok and Instagram and how the level of fear of judgment would increase just with those things. So if you think about what people are dealing with today, the young leaders, everybody, and the fear of judgment, how much it's increased because of that. How do you get people to rise above it? I think a lot of times is questioning our own thoughts, because as human beings, I think the fear of judgment can provide these limiting beliefs around ourselves. You know, people are going to think that you're an idiot. People are going to think that you're a sissy, whatever it might be. And then you ask yourself, is that 100% true? Is everybody going to think that way? Is everybody looking at us? Because a lot of times we have this thing called spotlight syndrome, where we feel like we are the focus of everybody's attention. Where in fact, everybody's so worried about being judged themselves, they could care less about what you're doing. But we rattle in our brains so much, and we get in our own heads about the sphere of judgment. So really just asking yourself and questioning your own thoughts, because you know those thoughts can go down some rabbit holes really quick if we're not intentional about putting on the brakes.
Oh, I love that idea of the spotlight syndrome. Yeah, I just read a book, it's fantastic, by Morgan Housel called The Psychology of Money. And he was telling the story about he used to do valet at a really high-end hotel, and all these guys would roll up in their high-end cars, and all of them would think people are looking at them in the car. And he said they weren't. They were imagining themselves in that car. No one is even looking at you. I haven't heard that spotlight syndrome, but I think you're 100% right. Let me ask you, you guys touch a little bit on about kind of the vision. I found it fascinating working with our clients, but also myself and our team. It's easy for us to look in the rearview mirror at the last 10 years, say, or 5 years, and say, think of how much we've grown and how much we've accomplished and all that we've done. And then we can recognize that. And the next thought also say, it's really hard for me to imagine that the next 10 years or the next 5 years, because I'm better and smarter and more capable now, and I'm continuing to grow, the next 10 years should be even more filled with accomplishment and all these goals. I'm struggling with this right now. How do you help people really, you know, embrace this confidence and maybe kind of addressing the two thieves to say, listen, everything that you've done will help propel you in the future when the future is also scary and kind of hold us back in some ways?
What you kind of just referenced a little bit is what we talk around the time continuum. So there are really three spots in time. There's past, there's present, and there's future. And really, the twin thieves are rooted in our brain for survival mechanisms. So I'll get back to your question in a second, but really it's rooted because even back in the caveman era, they were worried about judgment, because if you got kicked out of the tribe, Bradley, what would happen back then in the caveman era? If you got kicked out, you weren't good enough to be a part of the tribe anymore. What would happen?
I believe it would involve a saber-toothed tiger.
That's absolutely right. Yeah. You wouldn't survive, right? So fitting in and blending in and not standing out from the crowd was a survival mechanism. And our brains still have that survival mechanism in us today. And those social threats, You know, there's no saber-tooth tiger, but it's still a social threat sometimes, right? And a lot of times we're constantly predicting to protect because our brain's number one job is just keep us alive. That's what it wants to do, keep us alive. So we're constantly predicting things. And we have a strong negativity bias because of that, right? It helps keep us alive. So I'm getting back to your question, if you stay with me. Back in the caveman era, right, it was easier to remember, don't go by that cave because there's a saber-toothed tiger. Don't eat that berry because it's poisonous. Don't put your hand in the fire because you're going to get burned. We're not wired to remember some of the good things. We're not necessarily wired to remember the beautiful butterflies and the rainbows because it didn't help us stay alive. It didn't help us survive. So going back to your spot, the time continuum, if we are constantly focused on the past, right, a lot of times we're wrapped up because we have a strong negativity bias on all the regrets, maybe the shame, those feelings, right? That's where maybe some sadness, some despair comes to the root. And if we're focused on the future, that's another part of the time continuum, right? It's a lot of the what ifs. It's the stress. It's the anxieties, right? And the best version of ourself is our ability to be in the present. What can I control right now? Because you can look ahead 10 years from now, Bradley, but there's going to be so many variables that you can't even predict right now. So why are we getting so wrapped up in it? We talk about worrying and stressing about the future is like sitting in a rocking chair, right? You can sit in a rocking chair all day long, but you're going to be in the same spot. You can sit there and worry and stress about all the what ifs 10 years from now, but you know what? You're going to be in the same spot right now. So what can you can control right now and be present? So I think that's probably the toughest thing for people to do. And we're getting pulled in so many directions with our cell phones and our days, we're all over the place. But how do we just zone in and say, what's in my control right now? What can I do right now that's going to impact a bright future 10 years from now?
Yeah, no, it's really well said. And I think the discussion we're having with our team is that, and I think we talked a little bit about you and the growth in your career and your business is that there's all these opportunities, and if we're not careful, now we're saying yes to all these things, and we're feeling busy, and we're flying here, and I'm spending time on planes, and then you start thinking, am I through new opportunities that I love and I enjoy, and I think we deliver value in, am I avoiding the important work that might just come with me sitting alone in a room and really thinking about what's the most important thing? Anyway, I'm lying down on the proverbial leather couch for you, Steve, right now. But that, what you're talking about there, absolutely resonates with me.
No, and I don't think you're the only one, Bradley. I mean, look at all my gray hair. I'm focused in the future way too much, and I'm not focusing on controlling the controllables as much as I can. So it's a constant work in progress. But I think, you know, the highest performers, because we get to work with professional sports organizations, Olympic athletes, military, CEOs, it doesn't matter. They have a unique ability to focus on the present and be present because, you know, when you're focused on the past, it's great for reflection. You need to focus on the future to plan. But when we're talking about being the best version of ourselves, we're talking about being a high performer. It's our ability to be present as much as we can.
Much of our audience right now, I think, is coming off several years, certainly in some cases, a great 10-year run coming out of the Great Recession of just phenomenal success. In many ways, those could be kind of consecutive years that were championships for them. There's this idea that I've been thinking about, comes from Pat Riley, the idea of kind of this disease of me is that when you are having sustained success, whether it's a year or 2 years or 5 years, all of a sudden something can happen if we're not careful about our culture and, you know, largely the behaviors that support that culture, about how we start maybe overinflating our own accomplishments and our own contributions to the team. How do you help teams be really wary of culture and where it's going after they've had a lot of success?
Yeah, so culture is dynamic, right? So it's growing or it's dying, it's getting better, it's getting worse, it never stays the same. And, you know, when you're experiencing success, there's a lot of people that think that success breeds success, right? But success oftentimes breeds different challenges. And we experienced some of those challenges when we were on our 70-game win streak, right? And there are certain things that I think will force a team front to implode from within. So the better you get, the most likely person to beat you is you, right? So we oftentimes talk about it's not the water around a ship that will sink it. It's when water gets inside. So when you're experiencing success, it's a lot easier to look at all the uncontrollable factors out there, right? And get go down that rabbit hole we were talking about, all the future, right? Well, what about this potential recession? What about the market? What about supply chain? What about the competition? And we get fixated on the water around a ship when in reality, we should be focused on our own ship, right? And what are the things, what are the controllable factors that can't get into our ship that will sink our culture? So what we did is we got really clear and again, made it visible, which we talked about earlier. What things can't we allow in our ship? And then how do we develop the leaders within our organization that solve those problems the fastest and the most effectively? It's not about not having problems. Everybody's got problems. Every organization, whether you've experienced success or you haven't, I have not come across an organization or a leader that says, yeah, we got zero problems. Everybody's got problems. It's not about not having problems. How are you developing the leaders within your organization to solve those problems the fastest and the most effectively? And here's what I'm getting at. So when we talk about what can sink a ship, one of the biggest things I think is entitlement, right? I heard a speaker say once that there are three things you should be scared of in your life. Okay. Alligators, cancer, and sense of entitlement. Because once those things get a hold of you, they never let go, right? So that's one thing that can't get in your ship when you experience success. What else? Complacency, right? Because it's easier because, again, our brain's built to survive. Once we experience success, it's human nature to just want to sit back and say, yeah, we got it figured out now. We're good, right? The idea of how do you grow greatness is not hardwired in our brain, right? Getting a team to continue to push even once they've experienced success is not natural, right? So we have all these things that can sink a ship. And then, you know, the blaming, the complaining, the negative attitudes, the where am I getting mine, the finger pointing, all this stuff, right? And when you have leaders within your organization that are then taught you are leaders, you need to protect the ship, that's when you have a chance to continue to grow your culture, because most of those things are not happening in front of the CEO or the president, right? The employees you have, Bradley, are not the ones typically coming to you with some of these things. What are they doing? They're talking after the meeting. They're text messaging, right? And then when you can develop leaders that say, hey, that's not how we speak around here. Like, that's not how we do things around here. And they protect the ship. It's really important. Because the other thing that can happen sometimes is they say, well, yeah, we got a hole in our ship, but it's not on my side, right? It's on somebody else's side of the ship, right? So it's really important as you continue to grow and experience success to focus on not what's happening outside, but really pouring into your culture and what's happening on inside.
You talk about visibility there. One thing I've kind of been struggling with is I think we know when new people come on our team to establish right away, we have high standards and we're going to help you, you know, live up to them. The other part that we've been struggling with internally and again with some of our clients is if we start just documenting what exactly these high standards are, a few of them are pretty obvious and we can do that. But we've also found it's kind of like a rabbit hole and there's so many of them. Do you have any recommendations on how to really clarify or document those to say, we have somebody new come in, we have a mechanism in place to really articulate what these high standards are. And then we can say, whether it's onboarding, whether it's 90 days or 6 months or a year, we're going to really help you understand what these are, but they're documented up front. We've been struggling with that. Any ideas come to mind?
Well, I think the documentation is great. What is easy for organizations to do is have this big laundry list then, right? So I've worked with organizations that have 25 core values, right? I don't know if they're core values if you have that many. So I think less is more, simple is better, and then also articulating, okay, in this standard or in this value, here is above the line behavior and here is below the line behavior, right? Here is what it looks like and here's what it doesn't look like. So for example, if honesty is really important, one above the line would be talking to people. A below the line might be talking about people, right? And then it gets really clear on here are not only our standards, but here are the behaviors that are associated with it. Here's what's expected. Here's not what's not going to fly around here.
Yeah, I like that. And that's, I think, the easiest thing is sometimes we'll talk to folks about culture and they're like, culture, it's you just kind of know it when you see it and you know, feel it. I'm like, no, it's not. It's behaviors. It's the way people think and then the way people behave. And you can see it every single day. But I think getting rid of that it's amorphous. It's this kind of really squishy, cloudy thing that we can't put our finger on or identify. Like, the longer that persists, the further we're going to get from getting the behaviors that we actually want to see every day on the job.
Yeah, there's no doubt. And the kites do a great job with it. But basically, it's either by design or it's by default, culture is, right? So you're either putting together a blueprint, you're intentional about it, you're systematic about it, or it's what you just described, Bradley. It's just kind of how it feels. It's just kind of how it happens. Those organizations usually don't last for the long haul.
Yeah. All right. There's a handful of really great just concepts or frameworks, or in one case, I loved just a single word. I also reached out to Jen Zern. I said, hey, what should I ask Steve about that really has made an impact in your organization? She gave me one. So I'm going to give you a relatively short introduction. They do not have to be a short response, but I got a handful of these to go through to make sure. Number one, we're going to make strong recommendations. I'll make it right now. We'll make it at the end. This book, The Twin Thieves, I don't know, what is it? 15, 16, 17 bucks, less than $20 on Amazon. Strongly encourage you to not just buy one for yourself. I would say buy a dozen, buy 20 for your team. It's an easy read. And the short chapters and these principles that they just jump off the page at you. And especially for a sports nerd like myself, it's easy. But anyway, I'm going to start with this one that I really liked. By the way, I don't know if you saw a couple weeks ago as the NBA playoffs started, one team had three individuals, two of them punch things. One punched another teammate, Rudy Gobert, during a game in a timeout, punched his teammate Kyle Anderson on TV. I think the game before that, a guy named Jaden McDaniels got injured, frustrated, walks off the court, slams a wall, and then fractures his hand and he's in a cast. And I was thinking about that when I read this equation, E plus R equals O. What does that mean?
Yeah, so it's E stands for event, R stands for our response, and O stands for the outcome. And the idea of we can't control events, but we can control our response has been around for a long time. Back to the Stoics, Viktor Frankl wrote about it, kites. So it's been around for a while, and it's a really powerful, simplistic equation that there are a lot of events that happen every single day, most of them outside of our control, and some of them events that we wouldn't choose to deal with. But we always have an opportunity to respond to those events. And the better the R, the better the O. The better our response, the better the outcome. And we're really intentional about response versus reaction. Reaction is very emotional, right? You're not thinking through it. Response is very calculated. You're thinking about how can I best respond to get the outcome that I want? Because a lot of people in industry are dealing with the same E's. So it's not about the E's. It's about the ones that are successful just have better responses. And they're getting a better outcome because of it. And then the other thing that's interesting about that equation is that you can reverse engineer it. You can say, okay, what's the outcome that I want? What are some potential E's? Because the best leaders can see around corners. And then what are my responses need to be to get the O that I want? So it's a simplistic framework, but it's pretty powerful. We have a skill set that goes with it as well, but we love it. And when you start looking at life through that lens, as a leader, as a parent, as a spouse, I mean, we're dealing with E's all the time. And we start stacking a bunch of great R's, we'll start stacking a bunch of great O's.
Really like that idea of the reverse engineering, you're right, of putting that outcome, let's go in the future. What are we trying to do? Let's figure out how to reverse engineer. And you're right, I think there's always uncertainty in things that happen that you're like, oh, that happened. Couldn't really have predicted that. However, there's also a lot of things that are predictable. And this happens, you're like, oh man, I can't believe that happened. I'm like, is that just a phrase? Or did you really not believe that could happen? Of course, your customer or your, you know, competitor was going to respond that way. That should have been in the realm of possibility. I love that. That's powerful. I know this is not a Spanish word, but because I speak Spanish, I've been pronouncing it mudita. Tell me, how do you pronounce that correctly? And what is it?
Mudita. So mudita is actually defined as authentic joy for other people's success. So when you have mudita, I think it's a great litmus test for a leader. And I think it's a great litmus test for an organization. When you can have authentic joy for other people's success. Because the opposite of that, obviously, is envy, jealousy, infighting. That, again, when we talk about when you experience success as an organization, those are the things that will erode it from within. So when you have mudita, it's powerful. And it's also something that you can recognize. So we were really intentional within our program. When we saw Mudita, we made a big deal about it. So we had a young man that was injured. He was out for the entire season with a knee injury. But on Friday nights, he had the most Mudita. He could have easily sulked, went down on the sideline, isolated himself, and rightfully so. I mean, it was a senior year. He lost his senior year, but he chose to have Mudita. So he was the one, even though he had crutches, he was jumping up and down, pumping his crutches. He was so happy when his teammates experienced success. And then that just spread throughout the whole team. It was pretty cool.
I think we all know intuitively when other people feel that for us, like how it makes us feel. And you're like, this person is really happy for what we were able to do. Very related to that, I was thinking about this, the phrase, it's obviously, it's been around for ages, but comparison is the thief of joy. So a different thief there, but certainly related. And I've just kind of found myself is I got to be vigilant when it comes to social media and acknowledging that this can help us, in my mind, deliver value and connect with more people, and it has. That being said, if I'm not wary of it, I can get sucked in, and all of a sudden, I'm looking and like, man, all these other people are just doing all this stuff, and I feel stagnant, and I'm just like, what am I doing? But this is not helping me, and it's that idea. It's comparison is the thief of joy. So how might you help a team that doesn't really display mudita often or ever? How might you get them to start exhibiting that more?
Well, we did when we were kind of introducing it and trying to really get it going was just showing examples and then showing the benefit of it, right? There's a great clip actually from Bill Belichick, the head coach from the Patriots, in their film room. And he's actually showing a clip where they're in a game and someone had a sack. And nobody once gave him a high five, right? And everybody just kind of walked back to the huddle. They ended up losing that game. And then he showed another clip where somebody scored a touchdown and offensive linemen were swarming the running back and how well they played and how Mudita can actually help you get the outcome that you want. And it's the other part of it is having the joy in the process and understanding there's enough success to go around. And when you can create a culture of connectiveness, it's when one person experiences success, we all do. And I think it's what you get, what you recognize is oftentimes what you get, right? You got to emphasize it, you got to recognize it, and that's what you get. And understanding that not only can it benefit the team to have the outcome, it's also going to benefit you as a person because you can have more joy in the process. Because if you're constantly bitter or jealous or envious because of other people's success, man, it's just not a fun ride to be a part of.
There's this concept we talk about a lot, right? We recognize a lot, which is, and you talk about it in your book as well, which is got to pay your dues, man. And listen, I've been in construction for 38 years. I was doing this for 36 of them before I got my first compliment. And now there's this 23-year-old kid who's expecting a high five and a pat on the back every morning because they show up on time. You know what? That's just who I am, Steve. How might you combat that mentality? Because we have a lot of people who are happiest when they're unhappy on the job site building America. And I will say, was that effective for you? Did you enjoy that? They're like, no. However, got to pay it forward. That's how we do things. And you know what? It worked. We were successful with it. So how might you get people to kind of reframe that mindset?
Well, as you know, the only thing that's constant is change. Right. And that quote came from a philosopher in 475 BC. So change is inevitable. Growth is optional. And there is definitely a change on how people want to be recognized. But I don't know if that's a huge change either. So I think everybody knows the golden rule, right? Treat other people how you would want to be treated. Well, we believe in the platinum rule. Treat other people how they want to be treated. And just because you might be the person that never got the pat in the back or doesn't want the pat in the back, if you're going to be a great leader and a great teammate, you have to recognize that maybe some people, maybe in this other generation, in order for them to get, you get the best version of them, you might need to give them what they need, even though it's not what you need, you know, and it's kind of like the whole love languages type of idea, right? Is people need that appreciation, that pat on the back in different ways. Just sitting back and saying, well, that's not how we did it back when I was coming through. That's not going to help your organization or yourself become successful as things continue to evolve.
Yeah, I keep coming back to this very simple idea. It's four words, whether it's leadership, whether it's sales, it's life. It's not about you. And if you want to lead other people, it's not about you, right? So whatever you experienced, hey, you can build on that, but it's not about you. Do you want to build a relationship? Do you want to build trust? Do you want to help this person really maximize their potential? Then it's not about you, you know? And I just kind of keep coming about that. And I thought about that multiple times as I was kind of reading your book there.
Yeah, there's no doubt. I think that's so transferable in a lot of different ways. And the other thing that we talk about is the 10-80-10 rule, right? So about 10% of an organization that's going to be elite, they're going to be positive, they're going to do everything they need to do. You're going to have a big portion in the middle, about 80% that don't know how to function or what to do. And then there's always going to be the bottom 10%, you know, the energy vampires, the negaholics that are addicted to negativity, and they're going to find everything to complain about. And the key is making sure that that bottom 10% doesn't pull the other portion down, right? Because no matter what, you're always going to have the people to say, well, it is about me, you know, whether they say it out loud or they're thinking it in their head, right? But I 100% agree with you, Bradley, that, you know, it isn't about you. And how do we reach the people with different personalities and interests and how they want to be recognized?
This one came from Jen. She said this concept and then introducing the concept and then applying to the behaviors. She sent me a list of, I don't know, there's like 13 of them where I stopped reading. I'm like, all right, I get the idea. Whatever it's doing, it's working. Talk to me about catching criminals versus catching champions.
I think a lot of times leaders can get in this mindset of constantly changing or trying to correct poor behavior, right? Instead of taking time to recognize the people that are doing the right stuff. Because I think we've all been a part of organizations where the attention always gets brought on that bottom 10%, right? And the people that are contributing, the people that are showing up and doing what they're supposed to do, because they live out the standard, sometimes they never get recognized. And eventually, maybe they don't want to be a part of that organization anymore, right? Because right now it's a war on talent, right? It's about how do you attract and retain great talent. And if you're great talent and you're doing everything you're supposed to do and you never once get a, hey, that a boy or a pat on the back, it's tough to show up every day, right? So we unintentionally sometimes shine a light on the poor behavior by catching criminals, right? Instead of taking that light and shining it on the champions, right? And how do you intentionally and purposefully shine a light on the people within your organization that are champions, the ones that are moving the needle, that are doing the right stuff? And so what we did is we challenged the leaders at Zurn, the people at Zurn, a 30-day challenge to at least catch two champions, take a picture on their phone, write a caption on it, and post it for everybody to see. And it spread. It spread like wildfire. And people started to recognize. And ultimately, as human beings, we want to feel like we are a valued member of the group. We want to feel like, you know, we want to be recognized for the work that we do. And odds are pretty good when you catch those champions and you recognize them, you get more of that behavior. So I'll give you an example. If you take a lot of care of your front lawn, right, and you fertilize it and you mow it and you got a lot of pride in it and your neighbor's out for a walk and they stop and they say, oh, Bradley, you have the best lawn in the neighborhood. It's immaculate. It's unbelievable. And you get that type of recognition. Do you want to continue to take care of that lawn or you just want to let it to go to crap? What are you going to do, Bradley?
I'm struggling with a specific example because right outside there, my lawn is not looking great at all. But yeah, all of a sudden, it's like, oh, hey, I'm getting noticed. I need to not only maintain that, I have the mindset about we need to go reinvest, right? We need to do more of this.
Absolutely. And I think it's the same people within the organizations and the people we have the privilege to lead. When you're shining a light on that behavior, you don't get less of it. You get more of it. And then you also get people to take notice and say, okay, well, this is the path. This is what I need to do. And you get more of that behavior. So just being more intentional about catching those champions and recognizing those people that are doing a great job. Because if we go back to opening up, we have a strong negativity bias, and it's really easy to go down the rabbit hole in pinpointing all the people that are doing the wrong things.
Yeah, as I think about how often I do that, I think for me, it's probably over-scheduling is probably one of the reasons I don't do more of it. And I think probably as leaders, we probably overestimate. We go, oh, well, I congratulated this person or I wrote a handwritten note to this person. But when I have these days where I just feel like, oh my gosh, I'm stacking thing after thing after thing. If you don't have just some breathing room or margin for error or just downtime in your schedule, it's hard to find time to do that consistently. Do you ever recommend to leaders like having designated times at a consistent time in their calendar and or leaving a little breathing room to make sure they have time when they recognize it. They don't have to scurry off to something else. They'll have time somewhere in their day to actually build on that, to recognize it, whether it's their phone or an email or something else.
Yeah, we actually teach a technique called rounding, where you intentionally put blocks of time in your calendar to reach out, to recognize, to connect, to build trust, because it's really easy to let 3-4 months go by and not touch base with someone that you have the privilege to lead. And it doesn't have to be an hour of your day. It can be 10 minutes, but it's about the consistency. It's about the small drips that build that trust, because what great and elite trust builders do consistently is what average people do occasionally. And if you just do it occasionally, those people that are champions within your organization aren't going to feel valued and appreciated. And it's not always about money. I get money matters, but a lot of times those high performers, what they want to know is that they're seen, they're recognized for their great behavior.
Yeah, it's not the quality or the way you're doing it. It is just literally the frequency. You're not doing it enough. When you do it, you're amazing. I just need you to do that twice as much or three times as much. And when I say you, I'm looking at me. I need to do this. It's really easy just to get too busy and all of a sudden, I mean, on our small team, we have a new hire and it's like, I can't be too busy when we don't have that many employees. We've gone 2 weeks, I haven't talked to her. That's unacceptable and that's on me. But I think this idea of rounding, it's real simple. And when we have that chunk of time on the calendar, I'm coachable. If it's on my calendar, that's what I'll do. But if it's not, I can get swept up with, you know, all the other stuff we have going on as well.
It's amazing how many leaders and organizations say that the people in their organization are the most important part, right? It's people first. But then you look at their calendar and it doesn't correspond to those words, right? So if people are truly the most important asset, most important part of your organization, then there's no reason why you can't carve out some time to pour into your people.
Absolutely. So you spent some time with the Packers. Why don't we group them in? By the way, I'm a diehard Chicago Bears fan. No need to add any commentary to that. We're fine. Other than darkness retreats that I'm sure you were heavily involved in some way. What have you learned from working with the elite, as much as I hate to say this, the elite organizations, the elite athletes? What have you learned from them that you said, okay, spending time with them, seeing how they prepare, how they don't get bored with the basics, or if they do, what have you learned from spending time with the top of the top people that we revere watching on TV on Saturdays and Sundays?
I think you kind of stole my answer there. I think they just don't get bored of the basics. I think they have a relentless execution of being the best at the fundamentals and they don't get tired of it. They continue to water the bamboo, right? The old water the bamboo story and how you need to water that bamboo seed morning and night over the course of 4 years. And then finally, it explodes through the soil and grows 90 feet in 60 days. We call that aggressive patience. Can you practice aggressive patience? Can you be aggressive in the process, the day-to-day? Can you attack each day? But can you be patient in the results? Because we live in a very instant gratification, microwavable society where we want to see instant gratification and those results right away. But success is not always microwavable and relationships certainly aren't. So I think the idea of being the best of the basics, practicing aggressive patience, I think those are the things that separate them, and they're not sexy. There would be people that would come into our program looking for the silver bullet, you know, the magic potion, and they would leave and you could physically see on their body that they were disappointed. They'd be like, wow, you kind of work really hard and you prepare, right? Yeah, and that's it. And I know you're a big basketball guy, and we would use the great John Wooden quote all the time that when opportunity comes, it's too late to prepare. So what are you doing in the dark without a round of applause and a pat on the back so that when you get your chance that you can execute? And I think the best and the highest performing organizations do that time and time and time again.
Yes. Given both the time and my inclination to talk about such things, my failed college football career, but I will also say it was a turning point in my life, was that exact failing to live up to that. I had a somewhat unexpected opportunity and I was wholly unprepared with that. I'll just leave that as that, but that is a extremely apt point there. A couple of things before we go. I'm a book nerd. I always want to know either, I'll leave this wide open. Is there any book you either have read in your career that has really kind of changed either the trajectory or the acceleration of your understanding of leadership? Or is there something maybe relatively recently that you've read that really had a big impact on you that you might highlight for the audience.
Yeah, and they're probably not going to be ones that are mind-blowing to you like you've never heard before, but Atomic Habits to me is one that is just unbelievable, you know, by James Clear. I think he's an unbelievable author and provides practical things that you can do right now. Love the culture code around the work and culture and how important things like psychological safety are. Never Split the Difference. Have you read that one, Bradley?
I have.
Absolutely. A Negotiation. Chris Voss, sure.
Yeah, love that one too. Like I told you, you know, those are kind of my three go-tos that I think are really just powerful. And then I love books too. So my business partner, co-author Lucas Jaden, who wrote The Twin Thieves, also co-wrote Win in the Dark. So I like books like the one that we wrote that are short chapters, you know, a parable that's woven in between. So, you know, Five Dysfunctions of a Team is one that's kind of similar to that as well. So usually ones that are popular for a reason, and they're powerful. Last one I would say is Daring Greatly by Brené Brown. I think that one's a powerful book as well.
Yeah, the culture code, I believe that's where, I know it is. That's where I mentioned earlier was just that we kind of his five things that he learned from studying great teams of you're part of the team, we have high standards, I can help you, kind of those things. But I recently just bought 100 for this event we did, 100 copies of his book called The Little Book of Talent. Have you ever read that by Daniel Coyle, the same guy from The Culture Code?
I have not, no.
It's really short. Chapters are super short. It really kind of bridges a lot of what you talk about, but it's also just about whether it's a 10-year-old or whether it's a 75-year-old who's just trying to get better doing something. It's what are the little things we can do to develop our talent? And most of them fit right in with this, which is they're not going to blow your mind. It's just the little things, little tweaks to what you're doing that highlight that. But
I love it. That'll be my next read.
Super small, easy. Let me ask you before we go. And again, I want to highlight our connection here was Zurn Building Products. Hell hath no fury if you say Zurn Building Supply, my friend. You probably already know that. But they're the ones who connected us and they were absolutely raving about you. And Jen said, he's a sports guy, leadership guy, helped us in so many different ways. So congratulations on your work there. Again, I want you to make it really obvious beyond the book. And again, this, my recommendation to you, if you're listening to this, you got value from this conversation with Steve. Yes, you should absolutely buy one. Go ahead and buy 15, 20, buy 25 for your team, hand them out. It absolutely will give you zeroed out at least a 10x, if not 25x return on your investment there. So I'll put that out there, but where can people learn more about what you do and maybe describe what you do, how you help teams, and then where they can learn more about you and find more information about you and Lucas?
Yeah. So just real quick, the work that we do, we kind of look at it as a three-legged stool. So we work on leadership development, cultural growth, and mental skills or mindset. And we believe that you need all three, just like a stool, otherwise it's going to fall over. Because for example, leadership development, cultural growth is really easy when times are good, but when adversity strikes, what are the mental skills? What are the principles that you lean into? So that's the work that we do around our workshops, our keynotes, our deep work with organizations like Zurn. We do one-on-one executive coaching, and we really try to get to the root instead of just focusing on the fruit. So we have plenty of tools, just like everybody does, but I think a differentiator for us is our ability to get to the root. Things like the fear of failure and the fear of judgment that then is driving the behaviors or the things that you see on the outside. So that's it. Jaden-Jones.com is where you can best find us. We'd love to connect. And again, love the people at Zurn. Love Jen Zurn. She's an amazing leader, amazing person. And I can see why now you guys have a great connection as well.
Got it. And that is Jaden-Jones.com. We're going to link to the book. We'll link to your URL. We'll do all of that in the show notes. Awesome. Well, hey, I've learned a lot from you. This book, as I said before, is extremely timely. Got a huge ROI on my investment. Best of luck to you. And Steve Jones, thank you.
I appreciate you having me on. Appreciate you reading the book and this conversation. And congratulations on all your success. Love listening to your podcast.
All right, friends, how did that go? Hopefully you enjoyed my conversation with Mr. Steve Jones, author of The Twin Thieves. Again, strongly recommend go buy one, buy 10, buy 15, buy 20 copies for your team. Also, consider giving these books to your customers and the prospects that you care about. This is going to help them as well. So as always, I appreciate you investing your time and attention. I know it's limited, so thanks for spending it here. If you did get value from my conversation with Steve, If you would, do a small favor. Go to whatever podcast player you're listening to and go ahead and give us a review on there. Those mean more to us than you know. And if you are listening to this only as a podcast, you are missing out. We are recording these as videos and we are making these available in its entirety, but also in smaller chunks to make it easier for you to share with your team. And when you have talent and expertise like you've got with Steve Jones, sometimes these small little clips are exactly what a teammate or a customer, exactly what their team needs. And our whole goal is to make these easy to share. So if you're not subscribed on YouTube right now, go to Bradley Hartman and Co. Subscribe there. And again, share this. It's free. That's our hope. Our hope is to help you become better at what you do. This podcast was brought to you by the Simple Sales Pipeline. In under 30 minutes per month, for under $30 per month, you can organize and value your sales pipeline to help you sell more faster at higher margins. Learn more at thesimplesalespipeline.com. All right, friends, that's all I've got. We're going to close it out like we always do with our leadership mantra. You, my friend, are owed nothing. Deliver value first. Make it a great week.